Morning, church. If you have your Bible and you're sitting at home, make sure you grab it. We're going to Galatians chapter 6 this morning. I'll give you a minute to get your Bible and turn there. As you do, I want to begin by praying for us, and then we'll spend some time worshiping the Lord together by reading and studying His Word. Pray with me. Heavenly Father, we are grateful for this virtual environment, this ability to connect and gather with one another. Think about all of those who you have brought into your fold that are here watching online as we do this, and just specifically want to envision them, think about them, be speaking to them, and that your Holy Spirit will be working supernaturally, even though I can't directly see you, that I can see them, that they would be there connected, not by my power, my ability, not by our ability to do anything, but rather by your Holy Spirit supernaturally intertwined for the sake of your glory. And so help us and help us be a people of meaningful relationships from that. And we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Hey, I know I go to this kind of week in and week out over the last few months, but this is certainly a new, different, peculiar environment for us to be communicating through a camera lens and through a computer screen, and yet we're so privileged by that, so excited about that, and honestly just been praying about all of the ministry opportunities we might have virtually going forward. And so really just asking you to join me in that. We're going to continue to look for ways that we can provide content online, but also help stay connected to you, because it's not just me speaking to you, but rather that we would be a people in a church where we care deeply about one another, even if you can't physically come into a building, because that's all not that important, right? Relationships are what make the church, not physical places or physical sermon times or gathering times, but rather that we would be God's people in communion, in unity together. And so we're always kind of thinking about that. Just want to say thank you for being a part of this and challenge you to continue to press in, continue to reach out if you have some needs, comment on the Facebook page, send us an email, let us know that you're there, that we can continue to minister to you so that you don't get kind of slipping through the cracks, lost in the shuffle type of thing, but rather that we continue to be the church connected in unity, even when gathering together is a little bit wild or a little bit different from what it has been. So that said, I want to take you, staying with this theme of community, into the book of Galatians chapter 6. We just got a couple weeks left in this letter before we move on to our next thing. And so in doing so, want to move to what Paul leaves us with, which is the implications of all of the theology that we've been through in the previous weeks. And so really heavy through the first five chapters on the way the gospel works in our lives. And even in this last chapter, that's begun to be more about how do you live in light of the gospel. It's still not in your own power, but rather that the core fundamental of the gospel, according to Paul in the book of Galatians, is that you and I are enslaved to sin. We're incapable of living lives of perfection that God has demanded of us. And so in this sin, we set ourselves at enmity with God, and that God's standard of what He expects from us was known as and is known as the law. It was God's perfection in morality set out and given to us, not so that we could keep it and in our own power be made righteous before God, but rather so that we would fail to keep it, and in doing so, see that we indeed are people in need of God and can't get to Him by our own volition, our own acts of righteousness, but rather in need of somebody to do it for us. And so it is through the grace of God received in Jesus Christ by faith that you would be saved, that He came, sent His Son Jesus to live without any sin, without anything wrong, and then died to justify us or give us right standing before God. And so in that, Paul goes back to you can't be right by your works of the law. You can't be right by your ability to do things. You can't be right by trying to be a good person, because you'll try and you'll try and you'll try and you'll fail and you'll fail and you'll fail. And so what we needed was one who came and did it for us. And we are meant to be a people who place faith in, cling to, trust in Jesus as our salvation, not our own ability. Not only that, in the last couple weeks, what we've said is from this, God seals that promise through the Holy Spirit, giving us His Spirit inside of you, that you might walk by His power, not in your own abilities. Because even after coming to place our faith in Christ, Christians don't magically become good people. You become a justified person, which means made right, not guilty. It doesn't mean that you are instantly made perfect or without sin. That's why the church is wrought and filled with hypocrisy. It's why it's filled with people who just don't get it, who don't do things right, because you haven't been made perfect. Instead, what has been done to you is you've been freed from your sin and you've been given the Holy Spirit so that you might walk no longer by the deeds of your flesh alone, but that you could turn to the work of the Holy Spirit in your life and walk by the Spirit, that God Himself will lead and guide you. We call this process sanctification, that you and I are on this road of being made more and more in the image of God, being made more and more like Christ. Now, all of this has been this us vertical relationship. How do you and God connect? What is your relationship to God? Now, this lays the whole foundation for where we spend most of our time in our life, which is not necessarily vertical relationships, but is generally horizontal relationships. How do you relate to one another? You see, the reality is the Christian life isn't meant to be lived individual, isolistic, on your own, without others. It was meant to be lived in community. And you, even if you're at your home, quarantined, never leaving your house, never going anywhere else, are spending your time with others in community in some way, shape, or form. I almost promise you that that's the case for the vast majority of people. Those who don't have that don't find themselves in a really healthy relationship with the world. But the reality is, whether it's through phone calls or through emails or through some type of work communication, or whether it's even in your own family, that we are constantly in relationships with one another, and that ultimately the church of God exists not only to glorify God in our vertical relationship with Him, but what all of today is going to be about, Paul's kind of instruction to the church in Galatians chapter 6, is that that needs to infiltrate our horizontal relationships and the way we care for one another. So let me show you what I mean by that as we pick up the very end of chapter 5 and move on. Here's what he says. From last week, if we live by the Spirit, let us also walk by the Spirit. Now, what does it look like to walk by the Spirit when we talk in regards to one another? Look at how Paul plays this out. Let us not become boastful, challenging one another, envying one another. So let's talk about this. This word boastful there, the Greek word, the most literal translation means empty honor or vain glory, full of yourself. Let us not become full of ourselves. And then he gives two ways this happens. Now, here's why the gospel becomes so important in this. Here's why Paul puts this in the beginning of chapter 6, end of chapter 5, rather than early on in the letter. Because if you and I don't understand that our relationship with God is on a basis of His grace, not our merit, not our self-righteousness, not our ability, then what it does is, even when we do good things, it has a tendency to puff us up, to provide glory and honor to ourselves rather than to God. When we start seeing ourselves as more than we ought to see ourselves, what happens is we begin to boast and find conceit and find value in who you are, not in who God made you. Let me show you how it works, because he gives the two ways that this primarily happens and that we see this in our culture. Number one, he says, is challenging one another. Now this word challenging in the Greek, it's tied to a superiority, right? I'm going to challenge someone because I'm going to come up looking favorable against them. I do this all the time. Some of you know this about me. I'm a pretty competitive personality. And so there's always kind of a desire for me to not want to do something unless I have somebody that I'm doing it with, or maybe a more accurate statement would be have someone that I'm doing it against. And so if I go out to play golf, I want to find somebody that's going to play golf with me. And really what they are doing, whether they realize it or not, are playing golf against me. Now, the thing about that is I only want to find someone who I know that I have a good chance of beating. It's not just with golf, right? If I go running, I want to go running with someone slower than me. Our teenagers know that. We have some teenagers that do cross country. I don't want to run with the ones that are in good shape. I just don't. Like, the first thing I'm going to ask them is, like, well, how fast do you run a mile? Like, what does it take you? Oh, well, you have fun running, right? Six something? Oh, okay. Well, you have a good time. I'm not running with you. Now, if I find a teenager who is going to tell me that their mile time is, you know, in the eights, and so that's about what they run, I say, hey, you know, we got to go running together. Run with me. What I really mean is run against me, because ultimately, here's human nature. We look to challenge. We look to find validation in people that we see ourselves as superior to, and what it does, it produces nothing but pride. You look at our culture and you see this pervasively in and throughout the way the United States is right now. It is filled with people who don't ultimately want to set themselves on a standard that God might have for them, but rather that in our arrogance, in our boasting, have looked to those who don't have things together and have found ourselves to be good people on a basis of that person is not. And so as long as Joe over there is worse than me, I'm okay with God. And so I don't have to be righteous. I just have to be more righteous than insert John Doe into the blank and go, I'm better than him. Now, here's Paul's primary point of this argument, right? He's built this out over chapter after chapter after chapter in the gospel. Even the righteous things you have are not on the basis of what you have done, but on the basis of God who saves. You see, Paul was a righteous man. By the works of our flesh, by the confidence that one could place in their own ability to do religious things, Paul had done better than anybody else in the context of the ministry that he is going to. And yet he says, of all of these people, though I have reason to put confidence in the flesh, I find no confidence in there. I've considered that as lost, because the only thing that provides value is Christ, the grace of God in Christ. Me relying on me is not going to work out well, even if I find myself superior to other sinners. It's not me doing righteous things in my power, it's the grace of God in me. Let me try to give you an example of how it works, and I'm just going to warn you beforehand, like, there's a chance that this example is going to upset you. I love you. I know I don't know who you are watching this, and I don't have any way of controlling who's there, and I can't see your face and see you smiling back, but know that I tell you this because I love you, but here's how this works inside of the context of the church. We have this tendency to look at people who we think are most absurd and the worst of the worst and feel like as long as we're not them, we're doing a good job. And you know what it looks like in the context of today? It looks like highly politicized identity culture politics. Find the most absurd person you know and feel like, praise God that I am not like that person over there. Maybe you're kind of a left-leaning person and you go, praise God that I am not like that alt-right person who thinks everything is a conspiracy, who flies the Confederate flag on the back of their pickup truck, that they think women shouldn't have the right to vote, and they sneeze intentionally on somebody if they see them wearing a mask, and they're just the guy that is so obnoxious and awful that you go, man, thank God I'm not like that guy. He is the most absurd. Now, and maybe you're like this, and I think this is probably a majority of our church and probably the culture out here is you don't look at that guy. You look at like leftist Larry who is just, you know, crying when he thinks about how triggered he is from that guy that we just talked about and can't believe that you would possibly go outside of your house in times like this. Can't stand the fact that you wouldn't wear a mask, protests Abe Lincoln statues because he didn't emancipate the slaves fast enough, right? Thinks anti-vax people should be exterminated from the earth, right? They just go on and on. You can fill out all these stereotypes and you go, at least I'm not that guy. That guy is crazy. Here's what you need to understand. The fact that you have a standing before God any different than the most absurd, the most foolish, the most sinful person you know is on the basis of God's grace and mercy alone. It's not on the basis of how great you are. It's not on the basis of how well you stack up to someone else. So don't become boastful, challenging one another, because ultimately your standing before God is not based on how moral and how wise and how good you are. It's not you who is doing anything righteous in you. It's Christ through the work of the Holy Spirit working himself out of you that produces a right standing and a sanctification before God. Not only that, but here's the other tendency in the way that we tend to become boastful. He says, challenging one another or envying one another. Can I tell you what the flip side of that coin is? It's not the boasting pride of, let me see how I stack up to so-and-so because I know that I'll come out looking good. But rather that it's, let me look to so-and-so just thinking, if I could just be a little bit better. I know that's the person that I want to be. If I could just be like them, if I could just be like them, if I could just be like them. And in this inferiority, in this insecurity, just feeling like everybody else has got it together and I just can't seem to get there. And in a completely different context of how it plays out, the exact same behavior builds itself, manifests itself in your heart, that ultimately you have not a humility and gentleness to think about others as more important than yourselves, because ultimately it's the grace of God that brings you security, and so you don't need to envy someone else, but rather that you look at everybody else as something that you need to stack yourself against and feel like you just can't measure up. And so over and over again, you look at others and think, when am I going to be better? When am I going to be better? When am I going to be better? And here's when it starts to get really painful. It's not always you getting better that brings joy and satisfaction. Sometimes it's others getting worse. Amen? Sometimes it's when someone that you look to and you envy fails. When their life starts to fall apart, when they lose their job, when their family is eradicated, when their children are a mess, when something goes wildly wrong, there's this little, deep, sinful piece inside of you that goes, huh, yeah, see? And I thought my life was bad. This little part of you that relishes in the failures of others, what is that? That's pride. That's when we become boastful because, again, we have failed to see our identity on the basis of God's grace working in our life, and we've put way too much stock in our merit as the controlling factor between our standing with God and the purpose of who we are. And so Paul's warning as he moves in to how we relate to one another is on a basis of you and I only having good human-to-human relationships when we first understand a good relationship with the Father. That you have to understand the gospel. You have to understand that it's God's grace given to you in Jesus Christ, not by your own ability, not by your own merit, that will allow you to be someone who relates to others in a way that is valuable and positive and gospel-centric, because it'll be the only way that you relate to them, not trying to stack yourself up against them, either challenging them in some type of superiority, going, look at how good I am compared to who you are, or envying them in some sort of inferiority, going, look at how good you are in comparison to how bad I am. So Paul says, find your value in the gospel, find it in Christ, and when you get this, look at the outcome. Chapter 6 begins, and he's going to list some things that it does. I want to give you three things that I think you see when we have a good understanding of the gospel play out in the way that we relate to one another. Look at this. Verse 1. Brethren, if anyone is caught in any trespass, you who are spiritual, restore such a one in a spirit of gentleness, each one looking to yourself, so that you too will not be tempted. Here's the first thing. When we have a healthy understanding of our position in Christ by His grace, it enables us to be a people who hold one another accountable and restore one another in times of sin. Now, that verse here, let's kind of do a little bit of work, because this has an ability to be perceived wrong. When Paul says caught in trespasses, he doesn't mean that we're meant to be a people who walk around with some sort of spiritual policing in mind, looking for the time that anyone else we know might stumble or fall or slip up so we can gotcha and put them into some type of box or category as someone who's not spiritual. It's not what that word means. It doesn't mean I got you caught. It means caught, as in caught in a net, overtaken, consumed, pulled into something that they can't get out. This isn't simply the occasional slip up in sin, but rather that when you're walking next to someone in their life, desiring to glorify God alongside of them, you see some areas of danger, you see some things in their life that you know might pull them away from the Lord. You see them walking in these deeds of the flesh, practicing those things rather than walking by the Spirit. And the desire in showing them this entanglement, this caught up nature, is that you might restore them to right relationship with God. Now, here's the thing about this restoration. He says, you who are spiritual should restore such a one. Now, he doesn't mean this. I think this is the way we can misinterpret this, is to think that some of us have been Christians long enough that we've ascended to a point of being spiritual. I don't think that's what he means at all. Here's why. Because in Galatians 3, a few weeks ago we looked at this, he's going to give an example of such a thing. In fact, he's going to give an example from a time where he found one caught in trespass, in sinful thought and idea and practice, and he worked to confront said sin and restore him to something spiritual. You want to know who that guy was? Peter. Peter the apostle, Peter the head of the church in Jerusalem, Peter the walk on water, Peter the guy who preaches at Pentecost, Peter who we would look at and go, that's spiritual right there. That's varsity. Here's what he means when he says, you who are spiritual. And this is what I'm convinced of as we walk out the Christian life. Caught, entangled in trespass, in need of spiritual care, restoration, partnership, community together, is one that we will find ourselves on both sides of in our life with frequency if we live well in community together. In fact, if you don't have anybody in your life who is telling you that they see some dangers in the way that you're doing things from time to time, you probably don't have deep, meaningful Christian fellowship in your life. In fact, many of you would be well served to find intentionally relationships with people who know the Lord and are willing to tell you when they see sinful things in your life through courageous means, that they wouldn't simply agree with you in all things, but that they would desire to see you grow in your relationship with God, in your sanctification, in your walking in the Holy Spirit. And the reality is, the church today is filled with cowards who won't do so. They'll simply nod, smile, and agree with you for the sake of keeping peace rather than showing you what might be wrong, because the ultimate reality is we're very defensive people and we don't really want to be told that we're wrong. And so if you're like me, the first thing you're going to do is you're going to look for the things that person does wrong, or you're going to look for ways to dismiss what they said, or you're going to just kind of war and bristle against that, or you're not going to spend time with that person anymore. And yet, the desire that Paul has produced from a right standing in the gospel is that you would have deep, meaningful relationships with one another. Sometimes those meaningful relationships would be ones where you have somebody in your life who's willing to go, "Hey, Nick, I see some things that concern me. Have you really thought about the way you're approaching this? It seems wrong. Have you thought about the way you're thinking about this? Because it seems impatient, it seems sinful, it seems broken." And that you're meant to be someone who, in meaningful relationships in your life, might look and go, I don't want to tell you, but I need to tell you that this looks like an issue. It looks like you're walking away from the Lord here. Have you considered what you are doing in this? Listen, most of you don't need more people in your life who agree with you. You need some people in your life who are willing to challenge you. And look at this, in a spirit of gentleness. Right? If you're approaching someone with the desire to restoration, there's a couple things that Paul warns about. One, that it's meant to be with gentleness. Right, that you're not meant to do it bashing someone over the head. Some of you have gotten really good at that, going, "Oh man, I can tell the truth to anyone." In fact, this whole part that we've gotten to so far, you go, "I've got no problem being courageous and telling somebody when they're sinful. In fact, if there was a position in the church where I could do that, sign me up. I'd be great at it." And then he goes, "Oh, by the way, in a spirit of gentleness." You got to actually care about the person that you feel like you should ream with the truth. You got to have a desire not to just blast them, but to see them restored into Holy Spirit living. And you have to do so looking to yourself so that you will not be tempted. Because for one second, if you think that you're superior, or if you're capable, or if you're above said problem, that doesn't make you spiritual. Thinking that you're mature enough to handle it doesn't make you spiritual. When he says you who are spiritual, he means those who walk in the Holy Spirit, not boastful, thinking that we have this, but rather in a gentle humility, knowing that you don't want to be led by your flesh. You want to be led by the Holy Spirit. And the best the church can be is having relationships with one another that seeks to see that desire spread out amongst all of us, that we would be a people who are walking in the Spirit, which includes a desire to restore one another. So when we have a right view of the gospel, what happens in our horizontal, our human relationships? First, there's a strong desire for accountability and restoration. That's all of verse 1. Look at what comes with this, though, because in accountability and restoration, there has to be investment. And so this is what he says: bear one another's burdens and thereby fulfill the law of Christ. This verse is massively vague. What's a burden? Well, it just says burdens, right? The Greek word there, it means boulder, or something that's too heavy for one person to lift. Here's what the church is meant to be in light of the gospel. It's meant to be a place where we care deeply enough for one another that we're willing to walk in the hardest parts of life with other believers. walk not in judgment of them, going, boy, we're so much better than you. I'm glad that I'm not in such a position, but I'd never be in such a position because I do things right, but rather that in a spirit of gentleness, in a spirit of humility, in a desire to not be boastful, that we would come and go, man, I could see how I would be there. Let me help you to come alongside. In times of pain and trouble, that we would desire to connect, to care for, to help one another, to bring one another along. At the same time, not envying or not thinking, I just wish that I could have such a burden myself and that I could do something this well, that I could be somebody who is like this person with envy, but rather that from a position in the grace of the gospel that we would move forth going, I want to come alongside you and do this. And sometimes, let me say this, sometimes those are easy things. Sometimes they're quick things, right? We have a ministry here at the church where if somebody goes under surgery or has a child or and deals with a significant medical ailment or has something like that happen to them, what we try to do is we try to set up what we call meal trains. It's just a sign-up sheet where you offer to make a dinner for them and bring it over to them so that's one less thing that they have to worry about. Why? Because we think the church is meant to be a place where we bear one another's burdens. So maybe you've had something happen to you and it's really hard for you to cook. Send me an email, right? We'll set up a meal train for you and use it as a way that we can bear one another's burdens and you can allow us to bear one another's burdens, that we would come alongside and care for and help one another. Now, here's the thing. Sometimes it's something simple like that and sometimes it is heavy and deep and wide and it lasts a long, long time. Sometimes a burden is years of struggle, years of sin, years of pain, years of insecurity, years of anxiety, years of emotional rot, years of destruction that has to be walked side by side for the sake of the gospel slowly and consistently. It takes time and it takes energy and it takes counseling. And here's the thing. He came and he died for you, that you might be one who loves others in a sacrificial way like the same. That we would bear one another's burdens. Good understanding of the gospel produces relationships that seek to hold one another accountable, that seek to restore one another. It also produces relationships that seeks to bear one another's burdens, that we would be in this together. Now, here's the last thing. Paul, it almost like he anticipates the sinful human nature that comes out of this. Verse 3, for if anyone thinks he is something when he is nothing, he deceives himself. But each one must examine his own work, and then he'll have reason for boasting in regard to himself alone, and not in regard to another, for each one will bear his own load. He recognizes that there's two things that come out of this. When you go, oh, I can be someone who bears one another's burdens, that he goes right back to the end of chapter 5 and goes, here's what's going to happen. You try to think that you can do that in your own power. You think you can do that in your own ability. You think you can be someone good enough to do this. It's going to puff you up. You're going to think you're something when you're nothing. And you need to understand and examine your own work because it's not you who's working. It's Christ who works within you. It's not based on your merit. Or it's going to do this. It's going to make you one who simply feels entitled to everyone else solving your problems for you. That's hard for some of you to hear because honestly, you think that you've had a harder shake than everybody else. You think that you've gotten hard knocks and tough breaks all the way along and that ultimately, you're someone who has not seen the church do a good enough job in bearing your burdens in life and coming alongside you. And here's the reality. It's probably true. The church has a tendency to fail in a lot of ways. And here's Paul's recommendation. Here's Paul's instruction in the way that a good understanding of the gospel influences that. The church will fail. The church will fall. And each of us are meant to bear our own load. Now that word load, it's different than the word burdens. It's literally in Greek, it's translated backpack. It means that each of you will have responsibilities of your own. The last thing that gospel-centric relationships has a tendency to do is it has a tendency to make you one who wants to be responsible and wants to do what you are meant to do, not because you think that you can do it in your power or your authority, and not because you want to earn something, but rather because the grace of God has influenced you in such a way that you go, I've got this. I can do this. So that it equips me to not be a drain on the church, so that it equips me to not be a drain on the others in my life who care about me, so that it equips me to be someone who could bear someone else's burden with them, so that it equips me to be someone who could go and be accountable with someone else for the sake of their spirituality, that I would be one who looks at my responsibilities in the Lord and desires to walk by the Holy Spirit, carrying my load, carrying my responsibility, not being a lazy and selfish Christian, but rather that my relationship with others is based on the fact that God gave me His Son, gave me His Spirit, made me alive when I was dead in trespasses and sins, made me right before God when I was wrong and under His condemnation and wrath. That He sent Christ while I was yet a sinner to justify me, to put me in right standing before God, to save me by His grace. Now, the last thing is this. If you don't get that peace, if you don't get the right standing in Christ, none of these things work. Right? Accountability and restoration doesn't work if you don't have a right standing in Christ. Because it's always comparative. It's always about whether or not the person who came to you is good enough to come to you. It's always about whether or not you're better than him or her, and whether or not you have less things wrong in your life than they do. They never claim to come to you desiring to be someone who is perfect and therefore capable of giving you critique, but rather coming for the sake of restoration. Or maybe they come in a wrong mindset, and yet what they say is true. Without an understanding of Christ and a security in Him, we always flee ourselves right back to challenging one another, envying one another, becoming boastful rather than spiritual. Accountability and restoration doesn't work. Bearing one another's burdens no longer becomes about sharing the work with the sharing of the Spirit. It always becomes about this manipulative process of finding a way that somebody might owe you one, or finding a way to get what you ultimately want, or finding a way to find praise from others to go, oh man, you're so kind, you're so helpful, I can't believe you look out for others so well. Without an understanding of Christ, it simply becomes another way that we seek to measure up or measure past someone else. Without a right relationship with Christ, even you carrying your own load no longer becomes a shared work in God's glory. It becomes a source of pride. It becomes a source of our boasting. It becomes a source of our ability to do things to make ourselves look good. Paul puts all of this at the very end of his letter to the Galatians for this purpose. The gospel has never been about you doing the right things so that God will be pleased with you. It's always about Jesus, who did the right thing for you. Knowing that God's already pleased with you, not because of who you are, but because of who Christ is in you. that you might have God's grace in salvation, and from it, it produces a gratitude in you, it produces a desire in you, it produces a love in you that would cause you to look and go, I want to be someone. I want to be someone who works with others for the sake of being accountable, for being righteous, to restore us to greater righteousness, to continue in our sanctification. I want to be one who sees others' burdens and pains and problems as something valuable and something that I can contribute to. I want to be someone who can bear one another's burdens. I want to be someone who's not lazy and worthless and simply waiting for somebody to fix my problems. I want to be someone who carries his own load, all in light of the fact that he came to earth, that he took on your load, that he bore your burden on the cross, a weight that was too heavy for you and I, that Jesus came so that he might restore you. And he said this, come to me, all you who are weary and heavy laden, for my yoke is easy, my burden is light. When we have meaningful human relationships, it always goes back to a genuine understanding and faith of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Pray with me. Lord, bring us back to the truth. Bring us back to the good news of who you are. There's no hope in our abilities, no hope in our superiority, comparing ourselves to others, challenging others. There's no hope in our inferiority, envying one another, feeling like we just need to be better, we just need to do better, we just need to do more. That there's only hope in you, done and accomplished on the cross. That we would trust in it, that we would place faith in it, that we would continue to walk in faith in it, that it would make us a people desiring to be accountable and restoring one another, desiring to be receptive to said accountability in our own lives, desiring to bear one another's burdens, desiring to be a people who carry our own load. Produce it in us by the work of your Spirit. Pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Hey, why don't you stand? We'll sing one more song. What, who am I kidding? You're at home. You can sit down on your couch. Sing one more song with us together. We look forward to seeing you again soon. We love you, church.
Thanks for joining us, church, and please have a good and wonderful week.